How many of you play violin? Get out of here. How many play the viola? You stay. How about cello? Cello. Cello? Cello? Cello. Hi. How about the flute, the oboe? Singers. The whole kit and caboodle, right? The reason I ask that is just because what you're going to see this morning or hear this morning or both is a little bit of what we try to do individually with each student when they spend years with us, 2 to 4 years. We have programs that bring people to us from around the world. It doesn't matter if you come from China or from Japan, Honolulu, I don't give a damn where you come from. You're gonna play that boron because that's your bank account. Now, why is it the bank account? Why is this the bank account, the boron? Gives you the power. What else? Sound. Bravo. Without sound, we're nothing. Sound is everything. Heartbeat of our mother, as we hear it down in the womb, right? That's the whole thing. It's right there. So, do you have an app, metronome app? Good. You should have more of a metronome app so you don't talk to each other all the time. XOXO, what does that mean? I hate you. Okay, so what you're going to see a little bit of is a very long process of educating someone or trying to give them information that I received when I was in my teenage life in New York through a very extraordinary person called Ivan Galamyan. Ivan Galamyan was one of the greatest minds that ever tried to explain the four strings that we play on. Frankly, the boron. And as he said, what we do is 85% here and 15% there. Now you'll ask why. Well, because without the bow, you play pizzicato, right? Power. So, you can't hear me? Sorry? Well, come on down then. Why don't you all come down, actually? There's plenty of room here. So it's not us and you, or you and us, them and them. It can be confusing what the information you might hear might be a little confusing. If you are confused, the first thing you got to do, and don't use that iPhone, put it on paper, write it down, ask a question. I will ask you to ask me questions because I really don't want to lead anybody astray here this morning going out of the building saying, what the hell was he talking about? Okay? Because it is complicated. The concept is very simple, really very simple. That's why I said to you, Galamyan was extraordinary because he built on the knowledge that he received every year. He could help more and more youngsters understand it. This brain of ours is the slowest computer that exists. It's not a Mac, it's a schmack. It's a nothing, okay? It takes time. It takes time. Repetition, but proper repetition. Some people call it practicing, okay? Call it practicing. Proper practicing is very important. And the way we do that is we start with scales, actually open strings first. And I'll show you just quickly what I'm talking about. See, the concept is very simple. We have, how many levels of right arm do we need to play the violin? Seven. You're out of the ballpark. How many? Four. Why four? Huh? Four strings. How simple is that? Isn't that wonderful? Okay. So what we have is, basically, we have one position, two position, three position, four position. And if you notice, the elbow never goes beyond that. It doesn't go here, and it doesn't go here. It doesn't mean that you won't use it. But in concept, the bow has to be parallel with the bridge. Sound, it's called sounding point. And what we try to do is do this. Yeah, that's from last night. sounding point is here. It's about middle between the fingerboard and the bridge. It's called sounding point in English. We use English only. And we have to move the bow in parallel. With every sounding point, the bow must be parallel with the bridge. Now, this is the sounding point, the beginning of the sound. The next thing is here, see? It doesn't go, which it wants to do because the elbow does that, right? So we have to change that modus operandi. It's hard to start moving your elbow against nature. It's not easy. So we have exercises, hundreds of them, okay? There's your sounding point. Now, when you're here, that's a color. Some composers call it ponticello. Very nice. That's another one. Here. Sul tasto. But to play, and we use this position. I started that a few months ago. Why? Because you can see it. When you're here, you can't really see it. You should, but at the start, there's so much going on that you forget to look. So what we need to do is put the violin in the proper place on the shoulder, where you still are in contact peripherally with the eyes. Watch it. Oh, yeah. You don't watch it, you go, where is it? Oh, okay. So Galamian said, nose, scroll, exactly the same angle. Simple, right? Yeah, but most people go. Yeah, I'm a virtuoso. So, very easy. Now come a whole bunch of things. Bend your thumb and curl your fingers. Bend your thumb and curl your fingers. Because the bow must be flexible at all times. For release purposes, not for just the attack, but for the release. So we call catch release. Catch, stop the bow. Catch release. See how the bow is moving? We call this out. We call this in. Now watch the elbow. Without the elbow, you can't do it. Okay? And then we go. Now you may ask, do you ever not play like that? Oh my God, yes. Of course. Do you only eat with salt and pepper? No. There's salt, there's pepper, there's everything, Tabasco, you name it. But you have to get the principle in your system of sounding point. Sounding point, okay? So curl your fingers and bend your thumb. And if you really want to practice sometimes, put your thumb outside here and do that. All of a sudden, you'll see that it's much simpler. That's why we ask some people to play the viola, because the bow is heavier, it's a little more distance, et cetera, et cetera. So in actual fact, that's all you're going to hear from me today. In a very short time, it's very difficult to get all the information in to the person playing. Also, they are very nervous because you're all watching them and they're coming to play for Pinker Zuckerman, you know. So we try to break that. We try to break that mold because we all have problems, my God. And if we share the problems, we might come up with a small solution sometime, okay? So please write down questions because I will ask you if you understand what in the world we're trying to do here. Because the violin actually is a fantastic instrument. And if you do it properly, you shouldn't have any pain. You should not be injured. I've been doing this for a very long time. Hey, I release my shoulders. You bet I do. Why not? So does Federer before he plays. And when he makes a little boo-boo on a backhand, what does he do? He goes right back to fundamentals, right? Well, you make a boo-boo, you go right back to fundamentals. Ask some of my colleagues. I see them here from the RPO. We're on tour. That's all I do is play scales every day. Heifetz played scales every day. Well, he's the king. He still is. So don't avoid your scales. Those are very important. Okay? Good, good. You're good listeners. Unfortunately, we now have poor thing. Come on, Emily. English, right?
Yes.
Okay. Just checking. Japanese. To sustain. Up, up. 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 Yes. Up. Bow. Bow. Thank you. Second. Okay, very good. Very good. Good. Are you tired? Are you tired? You're getting tired. That's a good sign if you're tired. Because now you're communicating with us. You don't just play the violin. You're really telling us a story. Tchaikovsky is a wonderful story. You know? Many pieces, stories. Okay. A few little things. First of all, did you ever study with someone in Japan? From Galamio?
Koichiro.
Okay. That's why you understand what I'm... Okay. Koichiro is Harada. He was first violinist to Tokyo many, many years ago. Wonderful teacher. In Toho, no? You said you're from Nagano. Oh, so you went to Toho to study.
Yeah.
So you did all the Galamian principle. Miss Delay, excuse me. Yeah. Okay, so that's why you understand. Okay, good, good, good. See, it's easy. She understands the terminology. So that's why. So the first thing you need to do is open up your angle a little bit. You're not a small person. Okay? There's no such thing as a small or a big person. In fact, the bigger they are, the taller the person is, the harder it is to play. The angle is much bigger. So they become very small when they play. Smaller people think, oh my God, I don't have a sound. There's nothing to do with it. It has to do with angle of violin, okay? So when we start this piece, the first two notes, what does that symbolize to you? The first two notes of the piece when you play. Okay, introduction. The first two notes, kind of introduction, right? But also possible ending. Now we start with diminished chord. Okay, so maybe it's both. I don't know. I don't have email for Tchaikovsky. If I had email, I would say, hey, get up, help me, you know? So when I hear the horns going, I take over from them, okay? So, but you have to start with the vibrato. So the first two notes, you didn't vibrate at first note. You went, ta-di. In my dictionary, when there is non-vibrato written by the composer, we then use it as a color. Otherwise, you vibrate on every note. Every note. Okay? And this goes back to way back from Sarasate and Spohr and Paganini and Heifetz and Zimbalist, everybody, Kreisler, Menuhin, we all vibrate on every note. Otherwise, the music is dead. Because a vibrato is a release. If I spoke to you like this without the release, you would say, what's wrong with this man? Okay? So play the first two notes, and divide the bow into two. Party. Why don't you start extension of horns? Party, 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 party. A little more sound. Party. You know why? Two reasons: musical, but also your first impression. First impression. If you go, they go, Ta-dum, hello, I'm here. Okay, now bring your wrist down a little bit. Bend your thumb. That's right. And if you look while you play, before you play, look. Catch. Sustain, now. What? With chocolate. You like chocolate? Chocolate, yeah. Well, play like chocolate. Hello. Yeah, but you go. Sounding point. Use more bow. Right here. Why do you start here? Start here. Yeah. Good. Yeah, look. Save. Travel. Don't put your eyes here. Here. Feel your thumb. Yes. Flat here. Huh. introduction. Take your time. See, you are really listening, see? Amazing. Sound. Take your time, once more. Catch. No, catch. Flat here. Deep. One of those notes you like expression, more expression from the G sharp. Which one do you like best?
The D sharp.
After that. After that. Go. Piano. Now, which one do you like? Which one do you like? No, there's four coming up. Da-di-da-di. Which one?
A sharp.
Ah, bravo. Good. Well, then do something on the A sharp. Inside here. You think about it, it'll happen. Yeah, my problem with you is you go, be careful, not too high. Bring your violin up a little bit. Hana. It's one of the few words I know. Sound. And, okay, don't lose the sound. They don't know where you are then. There are 80 people behind you there, with a guy standing waiting to conduct. So, yeah. Lift. You don't lift. Like ballet. Yeah. Do once more. Party. Hello. Say. Again. Yeah, it's good. You see what you did now? You put the pressure on the index finger. Right? Hello, Mr. Kochiro. Once more. Do it again. Yeah, diminuendo. Same. Use energy here. Not so emotional. More boy here. More boy. Practical. Bank account. Think how much money you make if you sounds better. Don't go, Tchaikovsky. Okay? I am lift. Right hand. Good. Again, lift. Save. Travel. Save travel. Save travel. Sustain. Tie up pedal. Here it's easy. Here. Remember that? Okay. Right, that's a release, that's right. You're releasing and catching at the same time. Two functions, yeah. Up, up, up,
Up, up, up. He's not going away. Just put the bow. One, two. Right? Da, 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 da. One, two, go. Yeah. When you play Bruch concerto, you play Bruch G minor, same. Same place. This doesn't sound so good. Because it's thicker, it stops the vibration somehow. Much better, first finger, stronger. Now watch your bow. Bring your wrist down. Wrist down. Okay, now, a little variety in sound. Now that you have the bow controlled, make up and down, you know? Yeah. Oh, you know, Casals. Casals? Great cello. He talked about rainbow. He said, oh, the rainbow. So what the hell is he talking about? He meant phrasing, that's all. But also colors inside the rainbow, not just rainbow, one phrase, right? So the same thing, control the bow. Good. Yeah, this is a tessitura, my problem. I play here. Same color, yeah? Okay, think a little bit. I'm giving you so much information because he understands the language. So forgive me if I'm passing you by here. Use your pad a little bit. Yeah. Yeah, but you went. Travel. Look it. Save. Again. Save. Travel. Tell a story. Okay, once more. Unfortunately, I wish I can go on, but we have two more people. But what you need to think about is your fundamentals. Go back to fundamentals. When you were 10, 11, 12, remember Sunday morning on the train? Okay? That because you play very well. You have a beautiful sound. You just need to go back to fundamentals a little bit, and it will help you so much. It will free your whole everything. Don't forget posture, because if you do this, your wrist will come down immediately. When you start here, sometimes you tend to go close your hand. Don't do that. Just stay there. Just do that. 50 times. Release. So it becomes same motion, see? So that's very important for you. Don't close your fingers. You try and stay, always refix, yeah, fix it up. We don't have to exaggerate, but you know, when we play, we always close, but then we need to automatically fix it. So that's all. So, and don't forget the nose and the scroll. And if you start to move a little bit more this way, you will have more bow. Look. You also have pressure, counter pressure. See, when you have pressure, if you do this, it releases the pressure, as well as here. Again. Right? I picked that up for somebody called Isaac Stern. He used to do that. But if you watch Milstein, you watch Heifetz, oh my God, Oystra, that's all they do. They stand and go from side to side. Of course. Also, then it gives you more balance. Your feet then begin free. Your feet, it goes the other way. Right? And then eventually you'll start thinking this way. But if you start here releasing, oh, that feels so good. Because you have, now, when you get, after, you remember Lalo Sinfonía Española? Remember that spiccato, right? It's the same thing. Don't change. Don't change. So because it'll sound more diamond, it'll be like diamonds. Play pedetache. Good.
Cirque du Soleil. Have you ever seen Cirque du Soleil, how they fly up and down? Yeah, same thing. So easy. Please, by itself. It is, believe me, it's much harder. Also looks good. Okay, a few little things like that. Very good. Bravo, bravo. Thank you very much. Come on. Any questions? Sorry? No. Sure. Why, you look at me that much or what? Questions. Hi, hi, hi. Questions. Anybody?
Can I ask what your bar name is? It's a
I got it at Harrods this morning. A special delivery. It's she's very old, but she's a good one. Yeah. Lovely sound, you think? Hey, what about this? Do you like this too? It's all the bow, my friend. 85% is the bow. Yes, the violin does help, of course. And I'm very lucky to have her. 34 years I've been married to her. It's called the Dushkin. Sam Dushkin was a wonderful violinist, worked with Stravinsky, arranging pieces. And in 1980, Charles Beer went to New York, picked it up, brought it here. I met her in 64 in New York. And I played three notes and I went, my God, what is this? I really couldn't believe it. So I was very lucky to have it. Mrs. Dushkin wanted me to look at it before she sold it to somebody else. So that was very nice, very fortunate. It's one of the great fiddles. The two other ones that are about the same period. One is the Vuitton that Ian Stausker just sold. And the other one is the Joseph, that's the one, the Heifetz. And they're all 1741, 42. This label is 42, original, but he probably made the violin in 41 because he let it dry. And when he closed it, just before he closed it, he would put the label in. Where the other ones, the other two are 41 label, but give or take 6 months apart, let's say. We're not sure, but that's, and they're all totally different. But each one of them, in that particular 6 months, I don't know, maybe he was drunk the whole time, who knows. Yeah, so, anyway. Hi. No questions, huh? But you know everything. Okay. The bow? It's a Guthrie. It's a modern bow. I don't have old bows. They cost way too much money. If I have 50,000 pounds, I'd buy a house, you know. Besides, if it breaks, I have another one in there. Also Guthrie. I did pick up one in 71 on Water Street in a pawn shop. I found a... Charles B and I went to the pawn shop and we found a mare, which is actually, in essence, this is the concept of that. There's a split here, we're not sure who fixed it at Hills at the time. This is new, this is half, but it's a nice bow. I played on it for many, many years, but I've been doing this when I met Guthrie. I went to them. Okay, just a little more production, sound production. And when you play that many years with 80 guys behind you, any help is necessary. Okay. All right. Think of questions, please. I don't want you to go out of here thinking, God, that Zuckerman is a fool, okay? Because I can answer it or I cannot answer it. And I want you to go astray in what I'm trying to tell you. Because what I just did with her is exactly what we do. And the reason I could talk to her the way I did is because she already went through the whole method, the whole concept of sound production, okay? The music will always be there. Don't confuse all the stuff technically with what the music is. The music is there. It's how we produce the music through the bow arm, obviously vibrato, etc., as you saw, okay? So when I don't have that in process, in a situation like this, I have to go to major basics, which bores the hell out of you, okay? But I promise you, this is not a very difficult thing to do. You just need to know how to do it with the right person that understands, because there is no other way to play properly. Okay, we simulate. We're simulating if we don't make the right sound, because composers want their music to sound beautiful. I mean, beautiful. That's all they want. They wrote the bloody notes down, and then we have to make it beautiful. If it's not beautiful, they say, okay? And if you watch YouTube, which I'm sure you do, watch those great masters. There's no shenanigans in there. This is all worked out. I mean, worked out big time. And, you know, when people like Milstein, Schering, Piatigorsky, the whole lot, would come to New York, they would ring up Vanya and say, we're coming tomorrow morning for a lesson. And so I would get a message from Mr. Galamian saying, tomorrow, Piatigorsky is coming. Is that okay with you? Because you always have to ask the participants. That's another form of respect for the student. You don't just say, okay, sure, come. No, no, you got to make sure. I said, Piatigorsky, of course. I said, my God, I want to see him. I want to give him a big hug, you know? So he would sit there, and they would talk to each other during the lesson. Leonard Rose, the great cellist, told me himself that without Galamian's abilities to really explain, he could never actually teach properly. And he does exactly the same thing on the cello. It is the same thing. So does Larry Lesser today, his protege, and so on. So we just continue the tradition. We talk too much today. Galamian didn't talk. He would stop you. He would do a motion. He would say maybe out, maybe in, maybe save the bow, vibrato. And then he would say, you understand? I said, of course I understand. I didn't know what the hell he was talking about. It's 2 years. 2 years took me to say, maybe this man is right, you know? And it's because this was so slow. When I was 14, I want to be in the streets in New York, you know? I want to play pool. I went to rehearsals. I went to the movies. Girlfriends. You know what I mean? So, but that was Galamian. Steady as she goes. Every Thursday at 8 o'clock in the morning. 4 years. 8 o'clock in the morning. And if you weren't there 10 minutes before the lesson, you got a lecture. And it's you're late. That was the lecture. And the eyes were burning. And you know what? It's preparation. You don't just come, hop, 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 open it up. Blah, blah. No. Hey. Good? It's not bad, right? So it starts right there. How we open the case, even. How we take the bow and the fiddle out of the case. I teach that. He didn't do that. But I teach that. And do you know why I do that? Do you notice how, well, I have two bows, but I usually don't hold the bow and the violin in the same hand. Why is that? Sorry? That's right. One is emotional and one is practical. Why? Because we have two sides. Okay. So immediately while you're doing, see, I take the bow out with one hand, right hand. That's my money maker. So I take my money maker out first, you know, and then I take out the violin. Immediately I'm warming up. That's a reflex that we must bring every time we open the case. I open the zipper with the right hand and left hand. I then go together for this clasp here. But after that, it's all back to the same thing. Okay? Otherwise, it's mishmash. It's salada mixta. No good. You got to separate it every day. And it's a system. It's a system. We don't walk like this, do we? No. Isaac Stern said, left foot, right foot, same thing. We use different terminology. That's all. Left foot, prepare, prepare. There you go. Prepare, prepare, prepare. Same thing. Simple, right? Good luck. 54 years I've been doing this. And I'm still finding out new things every time I play. It's amazing. To help these guys. Okay, what are you going to play?
Carmen.
Oh, yeah.
sharp, C sharp. Now, that's flat. Once more. Ta-da-dum, start the motion of the bow. You know, tam, pa-pim, 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 tam, when you practice. But anchor the C-sharp. Yeah, and once more. Pam, pa-pam, pa-pam. Release. Yeah, if you don't release, you can't go up. Release on every dumbbell. Tam, pa-pim. It's getting better. And you do it quietly, not so forte. You do it 15 times. And then ta-ta, ta-ta, the opposite. Always, always do opposites, okay? Very important when you do rhythms, to do opposites. Always. You don't have to do it 15 times, but at least 10. Because it takes time. Okay, once more. Pa, the first note. Stand on both legs. Stand on both legs, yeah. No, vibrate before you start. Already in tune, you see? Didn't take long, did it? You feel better? Okay, good. Keep smiling. Let's go on. Good. Why? Why are you in my face? Why are you in my face? You know? This is, after all, she's trying to seduce somebody. You know? You know the opera, right? By the way, they banned it in Australia the other day. Did you see that? Because it evokes smoking. The Prime Minister stood up and said, "Why, you all nuts?" I wish they would do it over here. Anyway. Oh, you all seduce me, will you? Exo, exo. Exo, exo. And once more, once more. Bah, why? Bah, bah. Oh, you all. Do it once down below. Yes. Ooh. That's late. Yeah, shit. You know why? Your boat didn't travel. That's right. Now, you know, in our book, Mr. Galamen always said, when you go up in the scale, arpeggio scale, you do down bow. When you go down, you do up bow. That doesn't mean we do it all the time, but certainly here. Oh, no, 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 it's natural. Yes, isn't that easier? That's seducing. You're starting. When you have to think about it. It's coming from someplace, you know. It's not a violin piece. It's not. It's an opera. Okay. If you go see the opera, you'll see what I'm talking about. She has a little rose. She goes around, you know, all the peasants. Ah, it's fantastic. You know? So you get a color. Because right now your color is too violinistic. I like it. Don't misunderstand me. I like it a lot. But I'd like to see you going into another sphere when you play this introduction, okay? Don't think Carmen Fantasy, I'm gonna win the competition, okay? Please don't do that. We had 15, 20 years of only Carmen Fantasy at Juilliard. I'm so sick of it, I never played it because of it. I can't stand it, it drives me crazy, okay? Please, forgive me for saying that, but that's what it is. It's the truth. So just play the music, please. Once more, when you start. Just play the last bar.
Mm-hmm.
from the string. No, papam. But mobile. Driving the car. If you don't watch, oops, you're in trouble. Okay? Watch that road. Yeah. Amazing, the sound gets like this. Same. Okay, one, two, go. One, two, three, four, one, two, the bo, 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 bo. Don't think. Yeah. Bo, bo, bo. Divide the bo into four now when you start. Thank you.
think of? They always say to me, what are you thinking about? I said, what do you think I'm thinking about? Well, you think about the music. Well, of course I think about the music. How can you not think about the music? But I think of the bow, see? It relaxes my whole psyche. I get up there and I think, the bow, that's it. All of a sudden, I'm in the same place, you see? I don't get into the car one day and sit like this, and the next day I sit like this. Why? The car, bingo, you know? Well, you can use one hand, sometimes two hands. You usually start with two hands, right? When you relax, you start using, okay, so use the right hand. Audience, sing, oh, sing, sing, deep chocolate. Lacio Domingo would do that. Yeah, great singer, right? Tell the story. Tell the story. Bank account. Time, but you play very nicely, you really do. I think you're starting to think a little bit more. but what it is, sound production, right? Tee la dum, maybe down bow is better. Tee la dum, try once. Yeah, but then lift the up bow. Tee ya lift. Yeah, don't be afraid to go away from the string. If you go away from the string, it'll be easier to come back. If you don't go away, you can't come back, right? So, tee ya up bow. Watch Mr. Heifetz, okay? And turn the sound off so you don't get emotional when he plays. And watch his eyes. He never takes it off. Never. He was amazing. I don't know how he did it. We all of us, you know, we all go into hysterionics. He somehow, he was right there. All the time. Milstein, same thing. You know, especially when you start something. Because this is not a natural position. Mm-hmm. It becomes natural if you look. If you don't look, then what are you using your eyes for? You're looking on the floor all the time. Boys look up all the time. They're looking at mama. Mama, help! You know? Yeah, they do. It's amazing. Boys are so different, you know? They look up. You guys look down. Why do you look down? And if you feel really sometimes that you are in a box, Mr. Gingold, you know the name, Gingold? His eye, great violinist, he studied with him, he made him stand on the chair. I won't make you do it right now. But if you stand on a chair and play, you'll feel freedom. For 5 minutes, 4 minutes, okay? Use a good chair. I don't know, it opens up. Gingold made me do that. I said, why? He said, it's good for you. So I got on the chair. I've been using that all my life with people, and it's amazing. The sound, it goes like that. Then once you do that, you use the same chair and you sit down and you try to imitate what you just heard. That's very important. Because maybe someday you will not just stand up, you will also sit. Quartets, whatever. Okay? And make sure you vibrate, make sure you use a sounding point. With your fingers, yeah, bend your thumb and curl your fingers. That's good, exercise, good. So when you get to my ripe age of 25, you won't have arthritis. No, just keep moving those hands, fingers, all the time. I do this all the time, you know. I stand and wait for tutti's to be over. I go like this, I go like that. They think I'm conducting, but I'm not. I just do this, you know, a lot. Window wiper, see, look, it opens up. You know, it opens up both sides. We have to use both sides. We have a boy that came to Ottawa a few years ago. His name is Antawanan, Adrian Antawanan. He's Chinese Filipino, and he was born with a stump. He has no arm. Get on YouTube, watch him play. So whenever somebody didn't use the bow, I said, go talk to Adrian. And he would come back, like this, my God. Okay, he gets prosthetic arm, he puts it in, and he puts the bow here, he has a clamp, and that's it, and he plays. And you should hear what that sounds like. But he doesn't use any of our motion because he has no arm. But he does this. But I mean, my God, fantastic. The only other thing is, I think you should really listen to the opera if you can't go to the opera. Mm-hmm. If they're doing Carmen, please go. Get standing room ticket, you know, and go and watch what happens with the rhythm. Because I'm very, I get very, very sticky about ta 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 ta, that real Spanish, you know. They do the feet, they do castanets. Oh, Luciano Tena was a fantastic castanet player. And I asked her to show me the rhythm. In the restaurant, she took two spoons. Pum, 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 pum. Pum, 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 pum. I said, oh yeah, good, good, good. Thank you. So, it's good. Very good. Thank you very much. Questions? I beg your pardon? Yes. Don't ask me why. No. No, I got it from my colleague. When we play chamber music, we all have little things we buy for each other. And my wife calls me Koff in Hebrew. So Jessica Lindbaum bought me that in the airport. And I've had it for many years. Hi, Emily. So, any questions? Wait, Emily, one second. Over where? Oh, hi. I beg your pardon?
In Galamian's book.
Galamian, yeah.
Galamian's book. He seems to talk about five sound points. You're talking about one sound.
Oh, remind me what he means by five.
Well, the distance between the angle of the fingerboard and the brain and the bridge is divided into five points.
Oh, yeah. He did that. I don't do that. I break the fingerboard into two, basically. Yeah. Not for sound. I do it for comfort, let's call it. Because
yes.
When you play, again, it's concept. It's not necessarily in music when you play. But when you play, the fingerboard now is cut in half.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
Same. Flesh didn't do that. Flesh used third, five, and up. So it. We do that as well. So we just added a little bit to that idea. The five is to do with length of string. Hence why the bow has to move differently. Personally, I think in the book he had to put it down. He never actually told us that. He talked about sounding point, release and sounding point. Release means catch and release. But then when you stop the bow, you have to again catch it. See, it's all the index finger, come back. There's a lot of motion here. So we do a lot of it. We start with detaché. Once that motion is there, we then martelé. And immediately we go to colle. Colle is a pinch. Watch the point. That's the release. Right, Emily?
Yes.
Because now we're using the bow in three spots, totally different. But we begin and we do this. Number seven. Kreutzer. You start down, then you start up. That's not easy. It looks easy, but can you do it for them? No. But she has done it, so. Now the idea then to start here, now two functions. You have to catch the bow and cross at the same time. Ooh, this is a hard one, three strings. That's when you begin to use your elbow. See? If you don't use the elbow, but it comes naturally with many repetitions. So the bow then is your friend, which is what Mr. Galamian actually said. It must be your friend. I said, how do I do that? He said, practice. So, you know, he was an extraordinary time. He used time also to discipline the students. Because it didn't matter who you were. When that big hand hit 12, you were history. The next one came in. And he would start at 8, except on Thursdays. He would start at 7. And the fellow that came before me was Don Wallerstein. Because Don is a Luftmensch anyway. He didn't know if it was morning or night. So he gave him the lesson at 7. And he would stop around 12 o'clock for 1 hour for lunch and go from 1 to 6. And he did that except for 3 weeks before Medoman, summer, and 3 weeks before school started again. So he had essentially 6 weeks to himself. Otherwise, it was teaching, the whole time, Sundays included. So bloody miracle. He really was a miracle. And I know many, many great players that always went to see him. We always went to see him back again, not to play, but just to see him, to talk to him about music, about life. The guy was amazing. He spoke 6 languages. English was the worst, but he spoke Armenian, of course. He talked about old players from the 20s and 30s that he admired. It's amazing, and tremendous knowledge. But the bow is where it was for that 1 hour. And he had a system. He knew the psychology. He knew the understanding. He understood the person he was teaching. He didn't talk about it, but you knew he knew you. And I can tell you, there were so many times where he said, you didn't practice. Because he saw how I played. The minute I came into the lesson, within the 5 minutes, you think you did not practice. I said, no, I did. Not enough. I went home and I practiced. And then I screwed around again for 3 weeks later. But he had patience. As teachers, we must have patience. We must have. It's one criteria that is very important. So these are all part of the same thing, to make music sound beautiful. Otherwise, it's not worth it. You know, we're just simulating. Right, Emily?
Yes, right.
We know her. See, I know her, so I can talk to her that way. She met the person that really teaches, Patinka Kopek, in Israel, right?
Yeah.
A couple of years ago?
Yeah.
There was a camp, something up in the Golan, right? Kesher Dolon. And so she started with Patty, and then when she came to us this past Ottawa, she came and we worked. And I was very proud of the program that took place between this place and us to be able to let them have an ability to play in the orchestra, which they did last night, in the Ninth Symphony. But they didn't just come for a rehearsal. They were mentored already in Ottawa by different players of the orchestra, and then they had rehearsal, blah, blah, blah. And then they were comfortable to play it last night, which I'm sure they will remember for a long time. Because that's an experience that's invaluable. Invaluable experience to let young people be part of the professional world without any really pressures. No pressures, you know. Because it's hard to play the fiddle. Okay, what are you going to play? Oh, Barbara, right, sorry. It's in my brain. Thank you.
think you need to begin yourself to go further in your analysis of your own playing. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's fine for Patty, for me, whoever, to tell you, but I think once now that's more in that shape for you, begin to really look at and begin to really think about what it is that you're doing. Not that it's wrong or right, it doesn't matter, just think about it, you know? It doesn't have to be necessarily with the violin. You don't have to have the violin, you know, the violin in hand. You can somehow think about it in second person, if you like,
yeah.
Away, removed, objectively. Mm-hmm. Eventually you'll be more subjective, which for me means that you're listening to the sound coming back to you.
Okay.
Because right now you're playing beautifully, it's all pretty good. I just think you need to broaden your thinking a little bit.
Okay.
I'm not talking about philosophy now. No? So within that thinking that you do sound, projection, color, harmony, think of meter. That's very important.
Yeah.
And that will help you a lot.
Yeah.
Because all of a sudden everything gets, the minute you have that in the frame, your meter, I don't mean tempo, I mean meter.
Yeah.
And in a meter, you'll see that you have the freedom to be able to express yourself a lot more, a lot more. Okay, because that's all the music needs, really.
Yeah.
So you'll find that you have, you know, use all kinds of different metaphors, you know, shades of color, the horizons, the fields in Yorkshire, I don't know what, you know. I don't talk like that. Once in a while, you know, over a hamburger and a good glass of wine. But otherwise, I stick to that fiddle, you know. I like your posture. You're going back a little bit to your old habit. You're doing this way on the down bow.
Okay.
Open the angle a little bit, okay?
Yeah.
And when you start the second bit, that's a different color. See, that's what I mean by thinking.
Yeah.
If you thought about what you wanted to hear, just do that once more, the second bit. Yeah. Okay. What color are we talking about here? Red, blue, green, yellow.
I don't know. Maybe
you don't know. Okay, well, you think about it.
Okay.
But let me have a different color from the beginning. Play the beginning now. Okay. Maybe that's gray. Let's call it gray. Gray day in London. Sambo. We used to call him Sambo. I told you that.
Yeah.
Yeah, a wonderful man. He was so sweet. You know, that's so sweet. I was so lucky to know him, you know. The once more. Sweet, sweet, sweet. Sambo. Okay. Tell me a story. Do you ever start up?
No.
Well, try it. You don't have to pay me extra, it's okay. Just start down, start up, but guide that bow. You see, think about that bow, the meter. Don't
seven notes between the F sharp and the E. Give yourself time. More. That's what I mean by thinking, okay? Yeah, you go on Regent Street and you look at all those stores. Think about that E natural. You know all those shoes you see? That's my brain. Yeah, but don't close the angle. But slow, slow, slow. Even slower. You do it. Don't be afraid. Yeah. Singers do it. Good ones. Watch your wrist. Good, good, good. That's much better. You see, for me, that already has a story there. There's some content. It's not just Sam Barber, my Lincoln Channel. Okay? No, seriously. Okay. And it's beautiful. It's just a beautiful piece. That's all he wanted, to make it beautiful. You know? Okay. Can I use you as a guinea pig for a minute?
Yeah.
On the Sibelius?
Yeah.
Last movement?
Yeah.
Which you did, right? Have you continued doing it or you stopped?
I mean, I did it in the summer.
In the summer. Okay. Why don't you explain to them what it is that we were doing? Don't hold the fiddle like that. Last movement of Sibelius Concerto, after about 2 or 3 years, we used that as an exercise. The first five lines of the last movement. So show them what you've done.
Sure.
Well, you can tell them what it is in language that we try to explain.
I mean, so you have to catch the string and then release it, so and then travel, right?
First note?
Yeah.
And? But don't lose the sound in the long time. Okay. Explain that motion going up. What are you doing? Catch, release, catch release,
release,
catch,
traveling.
Release.
Yeah.
And so on the upper, you're traveling, so we divide the bow into three.
Mm-hmm.
Right? No, okay. Hold the sound. All the way, stop. September, October, 4 months. How long did it take you to get that into a good feeling?
Like 2 months.
2 months. That's pretty fast. Pretty fast. So do you understand that concept? You do? You're sure?
Oh, and also out.
That's right. So when we play up, we go in. We lighten the bow. We lighten the bow so it can travel. Paddy Kopeck, the great teacher I'm lucky to have, she added that. It took me 2 weeks before I could do it. It's hard. Exercise helps about 90% of everything we do. Everything. But you can't do it at the start. You have to understand what the arm does, what the bow does, how the function of out, in works, traveling across the string, etc., etc. And then if you do it for about 2 months, 6 weeks, thereabouts, you're a better fiddle player, which she is. From last year to now, it's tremendous progress. Tremendous progress. So don't go back to your old habits of, you know, going the wrong way. You're using that thing again. I can't stand that one.
Tried.
Why don't you do another one?
That
one is no good.
Well, which one?
The one, the Korean one. You know, the one I like, the light one?
straight, not with that little hollow in there.
Okay.
Because you need the support more there. That's the opposite. No, you didn't have to take it off.
I don't want you to see it.
I see it. I saw it. You know? So catch. Stop. In. Curl. Don't forget your thumb. Okay?
Yeah.
Good, Emily. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I wish we had more time. I really wish we had more time. This concept of what you saw today, when I first came to this country in 1968, I had one friend here that was in Meadowmount with me, Pauline Scott was her name. She played in the English Chamber Orchestra. And when I came to, and I remember Pauline from there, I said, Pauline, are you teaching? She said, oh yeah. I said, do they understand what you're saying? No. She said, it's really difficult. It's really, really difficult to make people go with you on this. You have to trust the teacher. Because as you saw today, I use all the vocabulary I have available that day. I use all my thoughts I have that day to help the person. I know Emily now for quite a few months, so I don't need to talk that much to her. She needs more orientation on the habits that she did or she had. She's coming back to doing this instead of... But if you notice the posture, the minute she walked in, did you feel good when she walked in? Well, it's because she's more confident. So, and she's looking. She keeps looking. She's a highly intelligent person, incredibly musical. She comes from Australia. And she's been doing a lot of wonderful work here. And she now has gone to another step that she wants to find out more about. And I hope we get to see her more often. And so, because what I was trying to tell her about thinking is you teach yourself. You begin to teach yourself through a process of understanding. And so we can only be a small little conduit to help them along in the journey, because this is a very long journey. She started now a really long, long journey, which hopefully will take her into her 70s. We as young people don't think of that. Well, how could we? But my goodness. And that's what it's all about. Because really when we work so well with people that understand the concept, they bring their own terminology and timing to their own teaching of themselves and ongoing. Because there is a tremendous need to share the information. Because I always ask my ex-students, are you teaching? The first 2 years, 3 years after they leave, no, I don't want to teach. Okay. 5 years later, they write me a message, you know I'm teaching. And it's happened so many times. And I said, great, I'm so happy. When I get to see you in Berlin or in Paris or wherever you are, I'll come into your class. Said, would you really? I said, of course. So I go and I say, you're doing well. This is great, wonderful, wonderful. And it's in South America, it's all over. So that's important because we then continue the tradition of good sound, with the least amount of headache, because we get so convoluted in our way of talking about music. You can talk about music, but when you take the fiddle out, stop with the talking. Just stop playing, you know? And it takes 2 to 4 years for the human computer, the brain, to get this into our bloodstream. I hope it didn't confuse you today, because from 1968, certainly here in London, to today, it's a different story, totally different story. And it's wonderful to see a lot of wonderful players here now making great sounds.
It's not just the conductor in the front, you know? Because it doesn't matter how they beat the Fifth Symphony. I'm going to play. I'm not going. No. And you ask my colleagues in the RPO, when we play that, I say, from the string. And they go, whoa, it's a lot of sound. But it's more than that, okay? So it doesn't matter what this guy does. No, I'm serious. And the good ones will tell you that. They add, of course, enormous information. A Barenboim is not just a conductor, you know? He's a deep thinking person. He never stops thinking. He's playing Schubert now. Why is he playing Schubert? Because he never did it before. He said he loves it. He sits at the piano and plays Schubert all day. Okay? So that's the searching. That's what I was beginning to tell her, to start thinking about aspects. And it comes naturally after a little time. So thanks for listening. I hope I see you again.
I'd just like to add my thanks from all of us. This man is tireless. He mentioned that he was at the festival hall last night, but what you see here today and the fact that he had this wonderful relationship with some of our students is as a result of a collaboration with the National Arts Centre in Canada and your fantastic Young Artist Programme. You've been doing it now for how long?
116 years.
Oh, that's
50.
And it's partly for this reason that we have this wonderful opportunity. I hope our future collaboration will mean that you will be here again very soon. Thank you so much.